all coming out on this blistery early winter evening. I particularly would like to thank Naomi for that wonderful introduction. I'd also like to thank the American Studies program here, the lectures committee, and last but not least, my new colleague and friend, Kate Ratliff, for bringing me here. I have a piece of video to show before I begin my talk, so enjoy the next 3 minutes. It's one of my favorite songs and artists, Common. Context of black life in the city. The corner congeals much of what scholars in the emerging field of hip-hop studies have talked about at length when describing the form's emergence. Hip-hop was born and spatially contained amid urban abandonment, midwifed by the evacuation of legitimate work, and raised amid marginalization of urban poverty. The city that built hip-hop was, to quote the writer and historian Jeff Chang, a necropolis, a city of the dead. It is no wonder, to use common words, that robbing, stealing, dying just to make a living are part of life in the city. Yet death, containment, the evacuation of legitimate economies are not the sole themes in common song. There's more occurring than the description of the current state of the ghetto. We also hear in Common's lyrics a mapping of sorts, a mapping of the bodies that move about and around the ghetto landscape. Indeed, these are not explicit articulations. He never says who he's talking about, but we know. Either we know it because we know the song, or perhaps we know it because we understand the spatiality of hip-hop. We know that he is talking about men. What's interesting about this is that even those who don't listen to hip-hop know that he is talking about men. Surely, you don't need to see the video which I've just showed you to know this. So the question is, why do we know, or at least I think we know, that he is talking about men? We know that he is talking about men because he is talking about people who move about, have access to, and control the politics, economy, and cultural production of the ghetto corner. Indeed, we know Common is talking about men not only because you've seen them in the video, or because of the subtle references to men in his lyrics. And he says, got Uncle Zach smoking something, blow up their nose to cope with the lows, the wind is cold and it blows, right? No, this is not why we know he is talking about men. Common is talking about, what Common is doing, it's talking about a place in which men gather, where manhood is negotiated and where masculinities are constructed. This explicit subtext of Corner is not specific to Common's songs. In fact, the description of the ghetto as a gendered male space is widely understood and accepted by both fans and practitioners of hip-hop alike. Everyone who listens to hip-hop has heard this subtext. No one names it because it's ubiquitous. It would be like pointing at the air or noticing that the grass is green, or for Vermonters knowing that there's snow on the ground. It is precisely its ubiquity and arguably its universal acceptance that makes this point so interesting. The interesting question is this. Are MCs narrating a male-centered imagined geography of the ghetto's public spaces that excludes women? Or are they illuminating masculinized ontologies that underwrite the social space of the hood? To put simply, are women present in the public space of the hood and rappers are not paying attention to them? Or are women not present because the function of public space in the hood is to reinforce their exclusion and we simply hear rappers talking about this in their lyrics? Well, I contend that hip-hop was constructed on a gender division of spatial access, where social space, the public space of the hood, the block, what Common calls the corner, function to normalize and reinscribe the marginalization of women. Now, this has profound consequences for hip-hop and for how we think about social space in our society. You see, hip-hop was born and nurtured on the corner, the streets that Common so eloquently painted in the opening epigraph of this talk. In parks, subway stations, and street corners, the practitioners of hip-hop were born. Yet all residents in this place do not have equal access to the spaces where hip-hop is performed and cultivated. Boys have access to the parks, the playgrounds, and corners, what Robin D.G. Kelly calls the spaces of work and play, while girls are often restricted from the dangerous spaces of the hood. This in turn genders the production and representation of hip-hop culture. It's audible in the narratives of MCs, as we just heard, seen on the bodies of rap artists. It is the ontology that informs the space where hip-hop culture emerged. My talk today will illuminate the gendered ontology that rests at the production of the public space of the hood, the space where hip-hop culture emerged and is cultivated. And in doing this, I hope to highlight how rap music has become an important site for the articulation of the black spatial imaginary, while also making the case that hip-hop must shift our understanding of where geographic knowledge is located. So let me talk a little bit about hip-hop. I don't get the sense that everybody knows what hip-hop is. It's a verb that sort of, it's a word that moves around constantly. Hip-hop means one thing to one group and another to another group. So let me say a little bit about what hip-hop is. Just gonna cover just a few bases. Hip-hop is an Afro-diasporic and Latino art form that emerged out of urban renewal, deindustrialization, and white backlash against civil rights. It first made its appearance on the scene in the 1970s and entered the public consciousness in 1979 with the song Rapper's Delight. Its home is the BX, Bronx, New York. Hip hop is an umbrella art form that houses three major elements: MCing, rapping, b-boy and b-girling, known to the public as breakdancing, and aerosol art, or graffiti. So I love visuals, and I always try to incorporate visuals into my presentation, so I have just a small film that I want to show, done by myself.
It's not a test, I'm rapping to the beat. And me, the girls, and my friends are gonna try to get your feet.
See, aerosol art, graffiti,
I'd like to say hello.
B-boy, B-girl, breakdancing.
I'm out of the purple and yellow. My first thing, I got a bang, bang. Look at you, look at you, say,
oh, I forgot one.
You the bang, bang, the girls rock. You don't stop, you drop the rhythm, that'll make your body rock. Well, so far, you've heard my voice, but I brought two friends along. Next on the mic is my man Hank. Come on and sing that song.
Check it out, I'm the CA dancing in the OVA hat. The rest is there for a while. You see, I go by the name of the doctor. The name is Keith Beans, I'll tell you why. You see,
I'm trying to shop with
you.
Became the first gold rap album ever until Run DMC took over in 1984. So four elements: graffiti, breakdancing, DJing, and the one we all know, MCing, the rapper. Now, of these four elements, MCing is the only one to emerge out of black cultural expression and and it is a form that particularly prioritizes black voices. As I said earlier, it is a Afro-diasporic Latino art form, but MCing is one that emerges particularly out of black cultural context. The MC, or master of ceremonies, draws on black spoken word traditions found in the black church, for example. Wordplay, rhyming, call and response. When I say hip hop, y'all say get up, hip hop, hip hop. That is something that you will find in every single black church, every single Sunday morning, and you also find it as a profound element of the performative art of MCing. So rhyming, call and response, storytelling, and performativity are the hallmarks of this tradition. Now, for the past three decades, rap music has been one of the most commercially successful musical genres the world over. For example, in simply 30 years, three decades, rap music has outsold the entire catalog of country music. That's significant, just in 30 years. And it has become the voice of a generation. As a matter of fact, hip hop is the only artistic form to be dubbed as a generational movement. Right? Jazz never did this. Bebop never did this. But hip hop is the only one to be dubbed as a generational movement. Cultural critic Bakar Kitwana calls hip hop, calls this moment the hip hop generation. Its birth in the economically abandoned inner core of the city has subsequently preoccupied many rappers with the urban landscape. Yes, from Jay-Z to A Tribe Called Quest, the city is ever present in rap lyrics. The study of space and place in rap music remains embryonic. To this day, only one study on the subject exists. Now, let me say a couple of reasons why hip-hop is so preoccupied with space. And I want to do this by talking specifically about the spatial context of the post-industrial city. As I said, hip-hop emerged in the abandoned core of the Bronx, New York. And what we begin to see by the 1970s is the evacuation of meaningful work throughout the nation. But this was particularly important within urban cities, particularly in the Midwest and in the East. Chicago, Detroit, New York, Philly, DC, Baltimore saw a precipitous evacuation of meaningful work. At one point in time, as you all know, the United States used to actually make things like steel and iron ore. We used to be a productive nation economically. We've transferred into the sort of information service sector now. But once upon a time, we actually made things. And urban folk, particularly working and middle class blacks and Latinos, were gainfully employed in these jobs. But the moment at which U.S. Steel collapses, the moment at which iron ore factories disappear, work disappears as well. Now, this had a profound impact on black and brown communities. What we saw was a doubling, tripling, quadrupling of unemployment. And with that, we saw a simultaneous rise in property crime. Now, in places like Chicago, the impact this had was significant on a number of fronts. One thing that it did was that it created massive forms of poverty. The second thing that it did was it allowed the existing structure of racial segregation to concentrate poverty into tightly confined spaces of the city. One of the places where this was most rampant was the Robert Taylor Housing Projects. The Robert Taylor Housing Projects were the grandmother or the grandfather of all American American housing projects. For a period of time, they were the largest projects in the world. They were built between 1958 and 1962. The projects were particularly built for black migrants leaving the South in the early part of the 20th century, particularly the periods between the wars. And they were built as an escape for the awful tenement housing that blacks lived in the city. My mother lived in the Robert Taylor Housing Projects. And working class black people were ecstatic when they opened, because they, as I said, provided a way out of awful tenements. And they were always dubbed as transitional housing. They were going to be, quote unquote, mixed occupancy, where working class and middle class would live together. Working class would move in, ascend to middle class status based on the economic foundation built through industrialism, leave the projects, buy a piece of property, join the middle class. This was the discourse. And this discourse was reproduced in every single black urban neighborhood across the country in the post-World War II years. Didn't work out like that. What did happen was that blacks moved into Robert Taylor Housing Projects and thousands of other projects like them. Queensbridge, for example, in Queens. Marcy in Brooklyn, right? And you all know those names. Why? Because you listen to hip-hop. Because you've heard Jay-Z and Nas talk about this, right? And this, again, demonstrates my point about the profound geographic implications of rap music. Going back to my point, black folk move in, the post-war economy sinks. Deindustrialization occurs rapidly. Black poverty excels exponentially throughout the 1960s and into the early 1970s. When I wrote about this in my dissertation, I did an interview with my mother, who moved in 1962. Again, ecstatic, right? My grandparents, ecstatic about moving in. They move out in 1969. My mother graduates high school in 1971. So I asked my mother, "Mom, what were the projects like when you went back to visit your friends?" And this is the phrase I used in my dissertation. She says, "It was another world. Everything was different. The green grass had turned brown. The nicely painted buildings had begun to disintegrate. The parks were eroded. Death and desperation were rampant. And the feelings of community had all but disappeared." The Robert Taylor Housing Projects had become a mini space of death, a mini necropolis. By the early 1970s, drugs, violent crime were skyrocketing, and hopelessness was expanding. As a response to this, the Chicago Housing Authority, the Chicago Police Department, decided to deploy forms of prison technologies, techniques, apparatuses into the Chicago housing projects, what Foucault would call carceral mechanisms. The Chicago Housing Authority put gates over the buildings. They demanded that all entrances and exits be monitored. Turnstiles were placed in the front of buildings. Residents had to wear identification tags. Security cameras monitored all activity in and out, and every single person who moved in and out of the projects had to check in and out. So these forms of carceral mechanisms began to profoundly shape the spatial order of the Robert Taylor Housing Projects. 22,000 people, 26 buildings, 16 stories high, a city unto itself, effectively became a carceral city in a little more than a decade. As poverty and joblessness in Chicago and Brooklyn and Oakland and other cities throughout the country grew, the extent to which these carceral practices made themselves present in these institutions, in these spaces, became more and more apparent. The home of hip-hop. But what does become interesting in this space, this growing carceral space where hip-hop emerges, are the gendering of the bodies in that space, particularly the ways in which masculinity is being shaped and constructed. Let me say a few words about masculinities. Now, often discussions about gender leave men out of the discussion. Men are biologized, women are socially constructed. Now, I find this deeply troubling. Bracketing men and masculinity from discussions of gender reinforces misconceptions about gender identity. It normalizes discourses that read men as biologically determined and not socially and historically constituted, and therefore, they are unable to shake off the masculine performances that they reinforce throughout culture. It concretizes the idea that, quote unquote, boys will be boys, and leaves little room for men to change and to be unlikely allies in the fight against gender equality. Now, dislodging men and masculinity from discussions on gender places much of the intellectual and activist labor regarding gender on women, absolving men from any responsibility whatsoever. To use George Lipset's formulation, masculinity is an unmarked category in which difference is constructed. Now, masculinity's relative invisibility as a category of analysis within studies of hip-hop and rap music are particularly striking. To date, only a handful of text studies on this subject exist. Now, before examining why so few studies exist on masculinity in hip-hop, it might be useful to lay a little bit of groundwork. What exactly is masculinity? Well, masculinity is part of a larger system of gender social organization, whereby social processes and histories shape the production of gender. Now, within this social process, masculinity is the hegemonic actor, the dominant force. Masculinity cannot be simply defined through characteristics or bodies, for example. Rather, it is an abstraction that manifests itself materially in bodies. In other words, masculinity and masculinities are concepts, ideas that become placed and attached to particular bodies. Now, masculinity is not an object that has natural everlasting qualities. It is not universal, nor is it biologically determined. In short, masculinity has no ontology. Masculinity is, like all gender relations, performative. That is, this is not to suggest that masculinity is an act. It is performative to the extent that the external acts and gestures that come to typify masculinity are social performances that are mistakenly characterized as an internal space. In other words, the maneuvers, performances that shape the ways in which we think about gendered bodies, boys moving this way, these things become attached to boys, blue, strong, independent, these things that become attached to girls, pink, weak, needy, are socially produced and not historically produced and not biologically defined. In other words, the acts, signs, gestures, qualities that signify masculinity are not the product of an internal biological essence, rather they are historically and socially produced through the public. It is for these reasons that scholars of masculinity like R.W. Connell refer to masculinity as a place in gender relations. That's very important. As a place in gender relations. Now, this place is the public sphere, and it is within this place that the practices through which men and women engage in gender are processed. Now, processing gender identities through place and gender relations has implications that extend beyond intellectual interest. This process shapes gendered subjects, it marks bodies, influences personalities, and ultimately produces culture. Now, while no universals exist in research on men and masculinities, there are two widely held truths in much of the literature. One, masculinity often occupies positions of privilege. Second, there are multiple masculinities. There's no sort of one universal. They are constantly operating and mediating each other. Race, class, sexuality, historical period, location, fragment masculinities, diminishing any notion of cohesion. Some researchers of masculinity make the case that masculinity should always be discussed in the plural. Stephen Whitehead argues that masculinities differ over time and space and context and are rooted in the cultural and social moment and are thus inevitably intertwined with other powerful, influential varieties such as sexuality, age, class, and ethnicity. Now, masculinity has been critical to the construction of inequalities. In other words, men have been instrumental in the creation of various disadvantages and privileges. Now, one of the places where this is most visible is mobility. Indeed, it could be argued that mobility is one of the major signifiers of gender disadvantage. When I teach masculinity in my classes, I often do a sort of test case. I ask my students, do people know Church Street in Burlington? What her sort of delight? The cultural hub, the urban space of Burlington is one street, Church Street. Yeah, it makes me laugh too. I ask my students, how many of you are comfortable leaving Church Street at midnight, 1 a.m, and walking back up to your dorm rooms or your apartments alone? Interesting enough, all the fellas' hands do this. Yeah, I'll walk right on out. I'll leave at 1 a.m, 2 a.m, 3 a.m. The women in the classroom say something very different. They say, well, if I do walk back, I'll make sure that I walk back with other women. And I said, well, why do you walk with other women and not by yourself? He says, well, because walking out in the middle of the night by myself on a Friday, Saturday night can be dangerous. And what that small little exercise demonstrates is that the ways in which gendered bodies interact with public space are profoundly different. Men, not always, but many men feel comfortable walking about public space without thinking much about the broader implications or the context. Whereas many of my female students are aware of the broader implications. They are aware of what it means for them to be out at night by themselves. And as a way to ensure their safety, they walk together. Social and cultural historian Robin D.G. Kelly, in a fantastic book called Your Mama's Dysfunctional. It's a really, really great book, and I highly recommend it. I love the title, Your Mama's Dysfunctional. Writes that the evacuation of legitimate work from black communities has created a context where play or leisure time consumes much of the working day of black youth. Kelly writes that these spaces constitute the flip side of work. However, what Kelly is suggesting is that the pursuit of leisure, pleasure, and creative expressions of labor, and some African American youth have turned to, has created what he calls cold, hard cash. In other words, play becomes a form of work. For those of you who turn your nose up at this idea, I ask you, can you play ball for 8-9 hours a day? If you can, you have established an ability to work. However, access to this kind of creative space is not equally distributed. Much of the labor created through leisure is gendered. Young men and boys have access to the space where basketball is played, the park, and where music is created, the corner. Indeed, as Kelly writes, young girls and women are often barred from the spaces where post-industrial labor is created. In other words, young girls don't have access to the basketball, to the park, to the corner. Now, because my interest is hip-hop, the latter of these two is important to me. You see, within the hood, the corner, as Common calls it, life is dangerous. As a result, only the smartest and toughest are able to negotiate. As Common bellows, the streets ain't safe because they ain't knowing the code. The code, which is short for code of the streets, maintains an adherence to street smarts and a willingness to use and survive violence. The code of the streets embodies a particular performance of masculinity, a performance that draws heavily on hypermasculinity. The corner is a place where it's hard to breathe right. Days of thief light, the beasts roam the streets, and the police's Greek life. Indeed, the corner is a space where male identity is forged, where masculinity is constructed. The corner is not a space for the weak, for the timid. Effectively, the corner is not a space for women. As stated, hip-hop was nurtured on the corner, performed on the corner. MCs battle, sharpen their skills on the corner. And if this place is a space that marginalizes women, what are the possibilities for women's active involvement in this art form? Now, we can go through the lyrics of MCs over the last two decades and hear the same narrative, right? We hear it in KRS-One's The Bridge Is Over, Jay-Z's Hard Knock Life, the notorious Big Things Didn't Change, N.W.A. Straight Outta Compton, Outkast Southern Playalistic Music, and Tupac's My Block. That is, space is important. Now, Murray Foreman, who has written a wonderful book on hip-hop and space, demonstrates that the preoccupation with space and place in rap music is informed by the emergence of black culture within the urban terrain, what Stevie Wonder calls living for the city. Yet, what Furman does not account for is the ways in which the public space privileges gendered bodies. Rap music is largely a male genre. Men's stories drive the discursive production of the music. Far too often, misogynistic narratives can be found in many rap lyrics. Their hegemony has unfortunately enabled anti-women and even anti-gay lyrics to be widely accepted within the genre. Now let's be clear. Rap music is part of the larger fabric of American culture. And in being so, homophobia and misogyny are elements of the music. Now, this is not to excuse their presence. Rather, I want to be sure not to single out rap music as being the authenticator or articulator of homophobia and misogyny. Yet, the fact remains that rap music is still complicit. Why? Why is rap music complicit in homophobia? Why is rap music complicit in misogyny? Well, I think there are a couple of reasons. Now, scholars on this subject, as I said, hip-hop scholars, have written a lot about this. For example, Trisha Rose argues that what rappers are doing, what MCs are doing, is they are filling a demand for misogynistic, violent, and homophobic narratives, many of whom are focused on the bodies of black women. It also seems that there are other factors at play as well than just sort of filling a void. It seems that it seems to me that the spatial production of rap music influences who gets to participate. If the spaces where rap music is socially produced, the streets, are largely male-dominated, what chances do women have to participate in the music? How does this impact the production of the music? In particular, the messages, narratives that emerge. What does the music have to say about the social production of black men's and black women's mobility or immobility, and the spaces, places that produce black manhood and black femininity? Now, I'm unable to answer all these questions, but I can say this. The spatial production of rap music within places like Oakland, Brooklyn, Washington, D.C., which privileges male bodies and marginalizes the bodies of women, profoundly influence the lyrics of the genre. In short, because the space of the hood, the block, what Common calls the corner, are not open to women or women's stories, subsequently, their voices are marginalized within hip-hop. Now, to be clear, I'm not stating that men on the corner or the block are the sole forces that keep women out, although many are complicit in this. Rather, I'm making the case that the public space of the corner is ontologically or epistemologically viewed as a space that is antithetical to women. In other words, the public space is not a space for women. So in closing, I just want to sort of restate the main points. Now, I have argued that the spatial containment of black poverty within the city, coupled with the prisonizing of public space of the ghetto, provided moral and parental justification to keep girls in the house. Subsequently, boys were freed from this and thus were able to spend time in the public space of the hood and subsequently participate, be a part of, participate, cultivate, and engage hip-hop. Women in hip-hop, because there are women in hip-hop, and there have always been women in hip-hop, must grapple with and overcome this ontology, meaning their marginalization from the public space of the hood. This, in turn, has created, I think, a hip-hop culture that places women's bodies and stories at the margins. Subsequently, the narrative stories that emanate from the lips of MCs are not only gendered as male, but display the worst elements of male culture. The evacuation of women from the landscape on which hip-hop is produced gives license to anti-women and misogynistic lyrics, because to far too many MCs, hip-hop is an arena for hyper-masculinity, where stories of boys in the hood are legitimized. Now, in doing this research, my hope is to shed light on the geographic imagination that lies at the heart of hip-hop. Stories about the corner, the block, the city. Hip-hop has a lot to tell us about geography, about space, and about location. It tells us about the political and economic realities of different spaces. It tells us about the containment of residents and their misery. Hip-hop tells us about the possibility of mobility and the creation of global communities birthed through the love of the culture on the one hand and the rootedness of place on the other. But most importantly, hip-hop tells us that black life is profoundly spatial. It tells us that to get a sense of black life, we must not only look at its economic formation, its political formation. We must not only look at the cultural products that emanate from the lives of black folk, but we must also look at the spaces upon which black life is lived and negotiated every single day. Finally, in illuminating the marginalization of women's bodies from the spaces where hip-hop is produced, it is my intention to use hip-hop as a marker by which to think about the gendering of geography in other spaces within the larger social world. Thank you.